in, grab a seat. We're going to get started. A couple things encourage you. First of all, enjoy tonight. All right? Have fun. This is a celebration. Secondly, engage. Right? There's probably some songs you'll know. There's probably some that are new to you. Just roll with it. And our goal is to celebrate and have fun tonight. You'll see a bunch of different things. So we're looking forward to spending time. Let's pray, and then we'll get started. Father, thank you for this. And may we just be a rich blessing to you as we celebrate the anniversary of your coming to this planet. So we give that to you with great joy. In your name, all God's people said,
Amen.
But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish.
In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelled in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone.
You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Of his government and of peace, there will be no end.
So lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas! Born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas! Make a joyful sound. It's Christmas! Let his praise resound. It's Christmas!
Gifted from heaven to a manger, the hope of the world, a light for all mankind. All of the earth rejoice, it's Christmas time. So lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas, born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas, make a joyful sound. It's Christmas, let his praise resound. It's Christmas.
Goodwill to all the earth and peace divine. All of the earth rejoice, it's Christmas time. It's Christmas time. So lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas, born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas, make a joyful sound. It's Christmas, let his praise resound. It's Christmas, so lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas, born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas, make a joyful sound. It's Christmas, let his praise resound. It's Christmas.
Thank you.
something about Christmas and kids, right? Wasn't that fun? That's a great deal. As you come as families, our hope tonight is that it will set the tone for your celebration at home. We know that many of you will go home tonight and you have traditions and things that you do. And our hope is that this will just facilitate all that and set the tone for joy and set the tone for respect, I think is a good word for the Lord. And so we're excited about your families tonight. And what we ask is just, again, enter in tonight. We've got a lot more stuff for you. And so we will just roll with this together and celebrate Christmas.
Of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. his fullness we have all received, a grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one else has ever seen God, but only God, who is at the Father's side. He has made him known.
Being strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light.
He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, forgiveness of sin.
Now proclaim his birth.
All right, well, we're going to need your help on this next one. So Jeff's going to teach us on the drums. We're going to do stomp and clap here. So let's try to get this down.
Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying,
Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us.
When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel.
This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house of Simon and David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room.
Thank you. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them.
But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Spirit world, We talked about how God intervened and the different ways he intervened. And we talked about Gabriel, one of his highest angels, who was sent on assignment to speak to a number of different people, Zechariah, Mary, and Joseph, and letting them know that this was of God. And so we've looked at those different realms. Tonight we'd like to just take a short look together about the realm of the Savior, because it's a unique realm, and it's a realm unto itself. In Luke 2, we read, the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Probably some of the most famous words in the history of the world and in the history of literature, written down, known by multiple generations. "For unto you is born this day in the city of David," that would be Bethlehem, "a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Certainly, just from history alone, we know that this is no ordinary child. We know that this birth has been remembered. And the title of Christ to his name is no little attachment. It's not been attached to anybody else other than some imposters down through history. Let's take a look at this title, Christ, because it's so familiar to us. We say the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's like a name, right? Like Steve Mitchell's, and that would be my name, and Jesus Christ, that's his name. And you think of it that way, but really, it's a little bit different than that. Christ is Greek for the Hebrew word Messiah. Right? So Christ and Messiah are the same. So really what they're saying is Jesus the Christ or Jesus the Messiah. Another way to interpret that would be Jesus the Savior. And this title has the fulfillment of three governing roles in the use of this wording. The first is, put the first one up here, is a prophet. Jesus was a prophet in the line of Moses. If you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 8, Moses said that God would provide a prophet like him, although greater than him, and he would be the one that the nation would listen to. And so many looked to Moses as the prototype of this Messiah that was to come. Of course, you know the story of Moses, right? He came, the 10 plagues, the journey through the Red Sea, and the wanderings through the wilderness. A prophet like that was going to arise. And so the title of prophet was attached to Jesus because he was in that role. The second one was the title of priest. Not in the Aaronic line. That was the whole the law. But this was in the line of Melchizedek. And you have to go back into Genesis and know the story of where Abraham went out and rescued his nephew Lot from some kings. And when he came back, this priest Melchizedek came out and blessed Abraham. And God said that this Messiah would be in the line and the order of Melchizedek. And in that sense, as a priest, Jesus is greater than even Melchizedek. We're not that familiar with a priest because we don't come from a Catholic background. That word's an unusual word for us. But a priest is one who stands in between and mediates between man and God and arbitrates for the people. And Jesus is our mediator. It says he is mediating or intervening or interceding for us up in heaven at the throne right now, this second, as we sit right here. He's a great champion to have on our side. And then the third role is that of king, right? He was also in the line of David. Both his mom and dad, Joseph and Mary, came down through the Davidic line on different sides. And so Jesus was in the line of David. And Psalm 2 talks about this and says that he was actually greater than David. Here's Psalm 2. It says, "Why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, 'Let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. By the way, this is not unique to this era. It goes on today and right now. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill, and I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. And now, therefore, O kings, be wise, be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. And blessed are all who take refuge in him. I want to focus just a little bit on that phrase, kiss the Son, lest he be angry with you and you perish in his way. The signature movement of somebody approaching a king was that the king would always have on his hand a signet ring. The signet ring was unique to that king, and all transactions, all agreements, all covenants were signed with a wax seal from that king's ring, and when you saw the seal, you knew it was the king. And when one approached the king would be standing or sitting, he would hold out his hand, and the person would come and kneel before the king and kiss the ring. It was a sign of submission, it was a sign of homage, and it was a sign of authority. And once you acknowledge the king, and if you acknowledge the king in a proper way, then you could have a hearing in the court of the king. This is what Psalm 2 is talking about. Jesus is so unique in the fact that he is the only person on earth who ever fulfilled all three offices in one person. Some were priests, some were prophets, some were kings, some were priests and kings, some were kings and prophets, but nobody had ever fulfilled all three roles. And in Jesus, all three roles are fulfilled. The great prophet, priest, and king. In Jesus' lifetime, he would fulfill 332 distinct predictions found in the Old Testament. You can look them up. It takes a long time to read them. But for tonight and our purposes, let's just look at eight. All right? Let's just look at eight major predictions. You say, what's so unique about Jesus? Come on. There's a lot of holy men. There's a lot of holy people. There's a lot of other guys. There are very few that claim to be God. Buddha, for example, never claimed to be God. Muhammad never proclaimed to be God. But Jesus openly proclaimed God. And there were eight major predictions that happened that set the seal on that. Prediction number one, he would be born of a virgin. Isaiah 7:14. We've walked through that tonight. We've heard them read that. Behold, the virgin will be with child. And we will call his name Emmanuel. Jesus fulfilled that in the New Testament. Secondly, he would be born in Bethlehem. Bethlehem was the town, the city of David the king, and scripture says that that's where he would be born. You know the story well. Up in Nazareth is where Mary and Joseph lived, and as the census took place, they had to come back to the town of their birthright, which was Bethlehem. Number three, he'd be tempted by Satan. If you read Psalm 91, verses 10 and 2, it talks about how the Messiah would be tempted. And we know in the New Testament, right after his announcement that he has arrived, he was taken out in the desert and tempted for 40 days. He was also betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. In Zechariah, you can read that story, and then later that's carried out with Judas, who agreed for a price of 30 pieces of silver that he would betray the Son of God and turn him over to the Pharisees and the ruling authority. Number five, the prediction in Isaiah 53, verses 1 and verse 3, that he'd be rejected by his own people. That the very people he came to save, the very people he belonged to, would reject him and cast him off. Number six, he would be tried and condemned. Of course, we know that story well. We're welcoming the anniversary, we're celebrating the anniversary of his arrival. We know all too soon we swing around through spring and we come to Easter. I think Christmas is easier just because it's a baby, right? There's something fresh, there's something new about a baby. It's only when we grow up we get into trouble, right? And that's true of Jesus too. The story changes quite a bit once he becomes an adult. And he wasn't everybody's favorite. Those who resisted God had a tough time with him. He would die by crucifixion. If you read Psalm 22 and Zechariah 12, some very powerful verses that are way before Jesus' time. It should be mentioned that most of these predictions existed 700 years before Jesus ever showed up. Some of them almost 1,000. And then lastly, he would rise from the dead. Of course, that's the great celebration point. We know this is the coming. We celebrate the coming because we know what he would do for us. We know what he'd carry out. We know what he would proclaim. And so these eight predictions, a person put out a wager for $1 million if anybody could fulfill in their life these eight predictions. That money has never been claimed. It's kind of a cool thing. Now, these are not, again, all the predictions, and just running quickly over them, but having these all fulfilled by one person, what's the probability of that, right, math people? The probability of one person filling out just these eight is 10 to the 157th power. Stop and think about that. When we were doing the realm of heaven and the realm of earth, we, in the awe series, we saw that anything beyond 10 to the 37th power is basically negligible. It can't happen. It can't be chance, right? It's just the margin's too small. 10 to the 37th power is like, it's for a sure thing because it can't possibly otherwise be. So just multiply that by 10 to the 157th power. It's the great underlying statement of history. There's no chance left in the equation. We know who it is that we're worshiping tonight. We know who it is who we're giving honor to. We know who it is that we're celebrating. And we know for certain that what he said is true. I'm going to ask the guys to come forward right now, and we're going to light candles. One of the things that's appropriate as we tie a bow on the package tonight is a word that we don't use very much anymore, but it's the word reverence. My camera, is my nativity scene up there? It disappeared. It's gone. Okay. Just imagine there's a nativity scene up there. Oh, no. Maybe. Worship team, you can come up to get ready. Be careful. No sword fights. One of the words that we don't use a lot anymore is reverence. There's not a lot of things that are reverent in our culture or our society. There's not a lot of things that we pay great honor to. But it's an old word that means a lot. It means you come with respectful awe. Honor is given to whom honor is due. If I just said to you tonight, who in your world is worthy of honor? Or maybe another way to ask it, who or what do you give honor to? It's an important question. And tonight what we want to do is really anchor down. Tonight we're celebrating the anniversary of when Jesus was a baby. Unassuming, vulnerable, utterly approachable, and yet powerful and great all at the same time. Herod would sniff out the greatness and the threat and seek his life in the next year and a half. He knew who he was dealing with, and he was determined to end the threat. But here's the miraculous point. He came. He came to rescue. He came to find. He came to adopt. Many of us are adopted children by that Lord Jesus who came. Our families here at Northview who have adopted know what it's like to fly to a far country to adopt their children. And they will tell you that there are not words that can adequately capture all of that, of what that experience means to them. They can talk around it. They can tell you what it's like, sort of, but they can't fully express really what's in their heart. And I think sometimes that's really true of us as humans. We know what we want to say, we just don't know how to say it. The same with Jesus. As you look on the screen right now, he has no words. He will have words later, but right now we worship him just for who he is and not what he's done. As we close out tonight, we have lit candles. Parents, you got younger kids, they got glow sticks. The candles represent that Jesus is the light, but it's also a picture of if it were a dark night and there were no lights and the angel came and talked to us, we would probably light a candle and walk to this manger scene to see if what the angel had told us was true. The worship song, Light of the World, let us see. Beauty that has made this heart adore you, all for our sake became full. One of the most significant moments in the history of the world. Will you rise and let us close out the service together in worship?
Dear Savior.
you go tonight, have a wonderful celebration. Make Jesus the most honored guest at your Christmas party. As you walk out, just take your candle gently, focusly. Lord, help us. Please drive safely. As it's rumored that it's snowing. So may you go in the grace